Welcome everyone to Ocean Week Day 5. We hope you're enjoying these special presentations. John Englander is an oceanographer, a multi-book author, and an Explorers Club fellow, having been first proposed for membership by no less than Dr. Sylvia Earle in 1984. The following year, he carried an Explorers Club flag, diving under the polar ice cap, and has since led many fact-finding expeditions to the Arctic and the Antarctic. In 2012, his first book, High Tide on Main Street, Rising Sea Level and the Coming Coastal Crisis, caught the world by surprise and established him as one of the leading experts on the topic. With extensive research, it covered the profound challenge of rising sea level with a geological perspective, including a full range of what could happen this century. A combination of leading research using common language, powerful metaphors, and some humor to explain the terrifying subject. John's latest book, published in April this year, Moving to Higher Ground, Rising Sea Level and the Path Forward, is getting solid 5-star reviews from a wide range of experts. He speaks to diverse audiences, such as engineers, architects, bankers, military leaders and politicians, and homeowners, connecting with each of their priorities and perspectives. He's the co-founder of a new nonprofit, the Rising Seas Institute. And if I may add on a personal note, John and I share a common point, having both worked for Jacques Cousteau, one of the most famous ocean explorers of all time. Though while he was directing the Cousteau Society in the United States, I was a young intern painting Calypso's hull in Southeast Asia. It is my pleasure to introduce you to Explorers Club fellow John Englander.
Thank you, Damien. It's a pleasure to be here with you during Oceans Week 2021. The issue of sea level rise is very relevant, but perhaps a little misunderstood. So a great opportunity to talk about sea level rise, and I would like to call it past, present, and future. I'm going to look at sea level rise, or exploring sea level, as appropriate to the Explorers Club, from a past, present, and future standpoint. For those that want to communicate and follow some of my social media, my Twitter handle is at John Englander. If we look at the world, the oceans, of course, are dominant. We estimate 72% of the surface is ocean as opposed to land. But of course, if you look at the depths of the ocean, actually the oceans are considered to perhaps be 98% of the biosphere compared to the relatively shallow biosphere on land. So the oceans dominate this planet no matter how you look at it. Most of us don't normally think about the two ice sheets, Greenland at the top and Antarctica to the south. And it's those two ice sheets that we're going to explore in the next few minutes as the determinants of the balance of land and ocean on this planet. Because we don't stop to think of it often, but the ice sheets on Greenland and Antarctica are the water reservoirs, if you want to think of it that way. And as they change volume, the oceans change volume, and that changes the land boundary or coastline. When we think of the Arctic today, we think of the melting ice, the polar ice cap, we think of polar bears, and what we're seeing is transformational. This has never happened in human recorded history that the polar ice cap is melting, receding, disappearing. It's going from bright white ice to dark Arctic Ocean. There's growing awareness that icebergs are melting. They're bigger icebergs as the ice sheets shed icebergs or calve them. And these very artistic forms of ice, I think, capture our imagination and make us aware that things are happening faster. Surprisingly, melting icebergs, like melting ice cubes floating in a glass, have no effect on the water level. And that's because ice is slightly less dense than water. So as it melts, it compacts a little bit. it's the ice on land, the glaciers. And as they melt and the water runs to the ocean, or as the glaciers calve new icebergs, that's like adding water to a glass of water or a new ice cube. And those will raise the water level. And that's why global sea level is rising. The other form of ice that we should understand as we explore sea level is the ice shelves. These are floating, flat, large areas of ice. One is shown here off of Thwaites Glacier in Antarctica. And that's about 100 feet of ice above the water level. But because ice floats about 90% submerged, that means that there's about 900 feet below the water level. So this thick ice sheet, perhaps 1,000 feet vertical, is breaking up and calving new icebergs. But from the time of the ice being in the ice shelf to breaking off into a new iceberg, that doesn't affect sea level because, again, it's floating ice, the weight supported by water. But in the background, we can see glaciers on Antarctica. And what happens is, as the ice shelves fracture in a warming world and calve into new icebergs, the glaciers then have space to move on to the sea. And that does add to sea level rise. So these are kind of the nuances that we don't often think of, but it's an important distinction to make as we look forward to what can happen with future sea level. Looking at a cross-section here of one of those glaciers from Antarctica, this is shown the Pine Island Glacier, but it could be Thwaites. The ice shelves again are coming out onto the water and calving into new icebergs, and there's a ship there for context. But what's happening now is that the water is actually eating away at the ice shelf underwater, as shown here. And that distance now going back under the glacier is up to 20 or 30 miles, 30 or 40 kilometers. So let's look at the past of sea level, the present, and the future. If we look at Florida, just to give us a sense of what has happened in geologic time, there are lots of other places, but Florida is particularly useful to show how this has changed in geologic time. We all know the shape of Florida today. But 20,000 years ago, during the peak of the last ice age, the last cold period, Florida was twice the size because sea level was 400 feet lower. 120,000 years ago, Florida was half the size because sea level was 25 feet higher. So geologic history informs us of how the surface of the planet, the landforms, change with changing sea level. And unless somebody takes the time to study geology and explore that part of Earth's history, they'd probably be unaware that landforms change that dramatically in tens of thousands of years. To put it in a graphical reference, again, sea level at the peak of the last ice age 20,000 years ago was 390 feet lower, 120 meters. Now, sea level did not rise smoothly. This is a kind of cleaned up graph from lots of scientific data, but you can see that there are three inflection points or changes of slope, where the trend of rising sea level abruptly changed three different times, most prominently about 11,000 years ago. And during those periods, if you had looked to the recent past and said, what's the rate of sea level rise, you wouldn't know what was about to happen as the rate of melting changed. And this has happened in the past many times, but as recently as 11,000 years ago. Now, to put 11,000 years ago in perspective, that's when the retreating ice sheets on North America formed the Great Lakes and Cape Cod and Long Island, just as a couple of examples. So what we think of as kind of immutable permanent landforms actually change over geologic time, and particularly as sea level changes. Sea level has been fairly stable for 6,000 years, as shown here. And I would assert, and I think there's little dispute, that the reason we have trouble believing sea level will change is that it has hardly changed in the 6,000 years of recorded human history. We tend to assume that it's kind of permanent. And if sea level's permanent height, the shoreline is a permanent location. But what this graph, exploring the past, shows us very clearly is that sea level has changed greatly. The rate of change has changed greatly. And in the most recent history of 6,000 years of human civilization, it's been pretty stable. To take us back to the last ice age with a little bit of fun is Ice Age Part Two, The Meltdown, the kind of famous kids movie of 2006. A lot of adults watched it too. My daughter was very young at the time. I got to watch this 40 or 50 times, way beyond anybody's appetite to see this, but I know the film well. And it's remarkably accurate in the big picture of what happened during the demise of the Ice Age. And again, 20,000 years ago, we had 2 miles or 3 kilometers of ice over most of the Northern Hemisphere. And as that two mile ice sheet melted and collapsed, and sometimes slowly and sometimes suddenly, the sea rose, the 390 feet or 120 meters. If we put all this information into a graph, this is kind of my signature graph in both my first book, and it's been updated into my new book, Moving to Higher Ground. This shows 400,000 years with carbon dioxide in green, a greenhouse gas. Red is for global average temperature, and blue is sea level. And it helps to see the past and actually the future, which we'll get to in a minute. But it helps to see this in context that, starting with the red line, global temperature has moved up and down 5 degrees Celsius, 9 degrees Fahrenheit, on a regular pattern for 2.5 million years, rather evenly spaced for every 100,000 years in the most recent million years, let's say. So temperature goes up and down. We're at the kind of high spot at the moment of the cycle. The 100,000 year cycle of sea level, of temperature going up and down, is about 80,000 years down and then 20,000 years up. If temperature gets warmer on the planet, there will be less ice and sea level gets higher. The converse is true as well. If the planet's colder for thousands of years, more ice will accumulate in the polar regions on land and sea level will fall. That's why the red and blue lines move together over a long period of time. Carbon dioxide, the green line, and global average temperature, the red line, they move together for slightly more sophisticated reasons. As the planet warms because of the solar cycles, what's called the Milankovitch cycles, that really are the triggers of the ice age, as the planet's goes through this natural cooling and heating cycle, the amount of carbon dioxide in the oceans changes. When the oceans are warmer, they release carbon dioxide. When they're colder, they absorb more carbon dioxide. So over thousands of years, the oceans will, or the CO2 levels, the green level, will change. As the red line changes by nature, the Milankovitch cycle, triggering the ice age, or being the ice ages, actually manifesting the ice ages. But there's a second phenomenon that also accounts for the reason that the green and red lines always move together, which is that if we put more carbon dioxide in the air, it will trap more heat and warm the planet. So historically, it's been natural heating and cooling by these orbital cycles, the Milankovitch cycles. But now, as you can see, the green line has shot up vertically like a rocket and departed from the natural range of 180 to 280 parts per million. And it's now at about 415 parts per million, 40% higher than in several million years. We'll come back to this graph in a minute. We get that information by drilling ice cores in the ice sheets of Greenland and Antarctica. And we can decode those layers of ice from those core samples by the air bubbles, the little bright spots that are shown in that slice of the ice core. We get those ice cores by drilling down in the ice sheets of Greenland and Antarctica. And for anyone interested, we do fact-finding trips there. And we have two this year, August 22nd and 28th. There is a space on each trip left. Please contact me if you're interested. They're stunning places to kind of observe, think about, photograph these enormous icebergs. So what's happening in the present? We've just looked at the past. At present, the two large ice masses, Antarctica and Greenland, are showing signs of rapid melting. Rapid in the sense of geologic time, which normally happens over thousands of years. Now it's happening over decades, visibly. Greenland is the place of the greatest change. And that's why we go to Greenland. I've taken trips to both. But Greenland is easier to get to. It's warming faster. It's showing greater change in the ice sheet, which will affect sea level faster, or which is affecting sea level faster. The size of Greenland is stunning. This is a fairly accurate comparison of the eastern United States and Greenland. It's just hard to comprehend. And that's one of the takeaways of our trips there, is just to see the enormity of the ice sheet and then to see how quickly the glaciers are melting at escalating rates. If we look at current sea level, we can, since we began keeping records back in 1850 through tide gauges, and then the much more accurate sea level heights depicted by satellite data, which started in 1992 or 1993. We're gonna have to cut this again, sorry. Okay. This is a break, obviously. We will edit this out. I'll pick it up again. 3, 2, 1. Looking at the graph of sea level since 1850, when we had tide gauge data, and then into the modern era, where we have much more accurate measurements of sea level from satellite data, you can see that the slope is fairly consistent. But if we look carefully, we can see that in the last two or three decades, actually the slope is increasing significantly. And we're seeing higher sea level manifest in extreme tides, strangely, because the rate of sea level rise, even at the current accelerated rate, is only about 5 millimeters a year, a quarter of an inch a year. It's almost impossible to visually observe a quarter of an inch a year height in sea level. But the place we see it is during the natural tide cycles, the daily and new moon lunar monthly tide cycles, or the king tides, which is an 18 or 19 year cycle. What's happening is over years and decades, as sea level gets higher, we're seeing it most noticeably in peak tides. For example, here's a storm drain. This happens to be in Florida, but could be any coastal community. And that grate was there to take excess rainwater and take it to some nearby canal. Now it backs up. This is a blue sky, what's called sunny day flood event in Florida. And the water has backed up through the storm drain, bringing salt water onto the streets in that neighborhood. That didn't used to happen 40 or 50 years ago when that street was designed. This is the oldest house in Broward County, where Fort Lauderdale is, Stranahan House. It's been there 100 years. When it was designed and built, the water did not come up onto the patio. It does now, very regularly and predictably, without any stormy weather, just by extreme high tides. Here's a street in Florida, in Fort Lauderdale, again, happens to be. There's a truck on the right and sailboat masts in the back. This is obviously a street. And they have a no wake sign, not for boats, but for cars to not drive so quickly during the peak high tide days, what they call sunny day flooding. That's the peak tide, and it's getting higher because base sea level is getting higher. So we're seeing sea level manifest with the peak high tides. It's useful to think about the different causes of flooding. And I spend some time in my books talking about this because we need the right vocabulary and concepts. If we think about coastal flooding, it can come from storms like a hurricane or a storm surge piling up water even higher. It can come from rain and then downhill as runoff. There's extreme tides. We've just looked at that. All of those things can be additive in a coastal environment. The first three are weather related. The tides are driven by the position of the planets. And then there's rising sea level, which, as we see, comes from the amount of ice on land melting, breaking off into new ice, new icebergs, or meltwater. And then something called thermal expansion. As the oceans warm, they also get a little bit larger in volume. Those are all comprising sea level. And then there's erosion, which we also think about and is not really sea level rise, but sea level rise may make erosion a little bit worse, but it has a different character than the weather-driven forms of flooding, the sea level and extreme tides. The big question, of course, is what's the future? And I'll go back to that chart we looked at a few minutes ago that, by the way, Dr. James Hansen and his colleague, Mexico Sato, helped me create this for my book, and it's been updated in the new book, Moving to Higher Ground. And a lot of people find this the best slide to teach climate change because it shows us that there was natural climate change and sea level changing 400 feet, roughly 120 meters, is a stunning concept that does relate to the temperature of the planet and the ice sheets. But it also allows us to see that sea level, global temperature, and carbon dioxide levels move together over long periods of time. And the wake-up call should be that vertical green line in the recent couple of hundred years of human civilization when we've been burning huge amounts of fossil fuels and changing the amount of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, which is a heat insulator. The problem is, or the question is, how quickly will global temperature and sea level continue to follow the relative direction of carbon dioxide, the greenhouse gas? At the moment, we're trying to slow the warming. We're slowing the rate of carbon dioxide emissions that are causing the warming. And it's important that we do that. But you can see by the incredible imbalance that where these lines have been moving together in parallel or synchronization for 400,000 years here, and actually for 2 or 3 million years, that they're now grossly out of balance because the carbon dioxide level is so high and temperatures are warming and sea levels rising, but with lag times of decades or even centuries. This will show us the recent past and predictable future in a little more detail. In the last century, sea level was rising at about 1.5 millimeters a year. That's less than a 20th of an inch. In the era since we've had good satellite data, not only is it more accurate, but sea level's rising faster because of the ice melting faster. We're over 3 millimeters a year. And in the last decade, we're now at about 5 millimeters a year. It's that acceleration in sea level rise, not quite exponential growth, but that should have us concerned because it's that acceleration which can change. And if you think of the pandemic, which we've all experienced recently, how changes in the rate can have huge repercussions over time and rather suddenly. And that's what's at work here. We're seeing an acceleration of the rate. It's not quite exponential growth yet, but the rate of sea level rise has tripled in 30 years. So what do we do? Looking to the future, exploring the future, if you will. There are some interesting designs that can allow us to plan for future sea level. This happens to be an area of Hamburg, Germany. It's about 60 miles from the North Sea inland, but it's a major port in Europe, and they have a huge flooding problem. So they've been very aggressive in designing for floods, but it also gives us some ideas that we might apply to elsewhere in the world for future rises in sea level. So I'd like to close before we take some questions and bring us back to this worldview. We live on land. Many of us have spent time at the ocean. The oceans are magical and important, obviously critical to the planet's ecosystem and for life of all forms, not only the eco-balance and the food supply that comes from the oceans, the fishing, but the oceans produce half our oxygen, the phytoplankton, and other forms of plant matter in the oceans. But the oceans determine what's usable, livable land. And we've always assumed that that was a fairly fixed map. But as Greenland and Antarctica melt faster and faster in a warming world, sea level will rise. And as sea level rises, there will be more ocean and less land. So I'd like to leave you with a couple of thoughts. We think of climate change as a problem. We should really break it into three issues. The sustainability challenges us to slow the warming as soon as possible by reducing carbon dioxide emissions. That's very important. But we've already warmed the oceans 1 degree Celsius, almost 2 degrees Fahrenheit. That warmer ocean is not going to reverse anytime soon, not in this century, no matter how quickly we slow the increase of carbon dioxide emissions. So we have to be resilient for this new era with warmer temperatures, more rainfall, more runoff, more drought, more wildfires. That requires us to design resiliency into our built environment, architecturally, engineering-wise, land use planning, policies for emergencies, et cetera. That is to be more resilient in this warmer world while we're slowing the warming. But even if we manage to switch to 100% renewable energy today, didn't burn any more fossil fuels, the extra heat that's already stored in the ocean is not going away soon. And that means that the ice sheets on Antarctica and Greenland are going to continue to melt faster and faster. So we need to plan ahead for rising sea level, which will very likely accelerate. It's challenging. Some people find it depressing, but I like to say, you know, it is what it is. It's kind of like getting older. You just have to kind of be realistic here and plan for our loved ones and for our legacy, and also to do what we can in our time in the world. And we must rise with the tide. The truth is, ignoring it, pretending it's not going to happen, ignorance, it doesn't help at all. And we have to think differently about sea level, which will change where we humans live in the world, or how we live on the coastal environment. We have to stay engaged with the coastal environment for not only recreation and fisheries and shipping. We are tied to the oceans. And even if the coastline is going to move a few miles or kilometers inland, we need to think and rethink our design and relationship with the coastal environment. It is going to change. For those interested in more information, I have a website, johnenglander.net. I do a regular blog and newsletter. There's Twitter and the other social media. And again, my new book, which just came out, it's available on all the normal sources, online and bookstores, I think, both in print, audiobook, and ebook. So I hope this has been informative, and I do look forward to taking questions. To understand the magnitude of what is happening these days in Greenland, it's useful to look at a film that was shot about a decade ago, Chasing Ice. This is the official trailer with James Balog. And it's extraordinary because it happened to catch in real time, because he had a series of cameras around the Arctic hoping to capture something dramatic. And stronger than any other visual evidence, this 4-minute clip from a place in Greenland that we go to on our fact-finding trips will show you the enormity of the glacier collapsing and what's going on at the scale. He also shows the scale of this in relation to Manhattan, just to give you a sense of scale. So let's watch this clip.
I'm on the phone with Jim on one of our regular check-ins. Like, Jim, nothing's happening.
It's starting, Adam, I think. Adam, it's starting.
Look at that. Look at the whole thing.
It all started in Iceland.
I think I'm so certain to get wet, I'll take my boots off.
I never imagined that you could see glaciers this big disappearing in such a short time. There's a powerful piece of history that's unfolding in these pictures, and I have to go back. The initial goal was to put out 25 cameras for 3 years, shoot every hour as long as it was daylight, that would show you how the landscape was changing.
Oh, this is the way to travel, my friend.
Putting really delicate electronics in the harshest conditions on the planet.
It's not the nicest environment for technology.
I do not want to go any lower than this. It's just bottomless.
I'm going out here on this broken fin, and I assume it won't collapse.
Every once in a while, you get sane. What were you thinking? Maybe that office job wasn't so bad.
This thing is loose.
Rock!
It's not working.
God!
All of that obsession means nothing if it doesn't work.
Just be careful. Don't get too close to the edge, all right?
This is terrifying.
His knee has had two surgeries, and it really could use a third.
He goes to that point where he can't anymore, and sometimes he's going further.
We have low operation engine number two.
This is big stuff happening right now.
Okay, onward.
This is the memory of the landscape. That landscape is gone. It may never be seen again in the history of civilization, and it's stored right here.
I got really excited to create a pattern for the Konkan since growing up me and so many of my friends had one. My name is Lynn Fritz and I work as an illustrator and animator. I mainly work digitally with a wide range of editorial and commercial projects, creating characters and clean lines. So with this project, I decided to experiment a bit outside my everyday comfort zone. Growing up, my dad would never stop reminding me of the importance of being outside and taking care of nature. So for this Konkan art project, I want to bring awareness to one of the biggest concerns facing our oceans and our planet today. My Konkan became an abstract pattern inspired by pieces of plastic.
One, two, three. Thank you, everyone, for staying with us. Please send in your questions to the chat room. Now, John, we have a few questions for you from around the world. What is your range of estimates for higher sea level by mid-century and over the next century? The best case and the worst case scenario, from Shannon in Florida.
Great question. It's hard to predict because we don't know how the ice sheets will collapse, of course, as mentioned. But I think it's reasonable to plan on up to a foot or two by mid-century, 50 centimeters. And depending on what we do with slowing the warming, by end of century, we could have a couple of meters, 2 or 3 meters, at 7 to 10 feet, of course. And the even more concerning thing is that the rate will be accelerating, almost certainly, unless we do something radical to slow the greenhouse gas emissions. And if that happens in early part of next century, 80, 90 years from now, getting out to 2120, 100 years from now, things will be much faster. So the challenge is how to design with the typical structures, buildings, and infrastructure that last 50 to 100 years and longer.
Very well. Another question from Natalie in Australia. Are sea level rising the same all over the world?
Great question, actually. And it's counterintuitive. Again, it's sea level rises globally, but the amount changes a little bit for several reasons. One, locally, if the land is going down or up, what we call subsidence or uplift, that has an effect on relative sea level in that location. Also, as ocean currents change, water piles up, if you will, on different sides of each ocean in different ways. So, and then there's another phenomenon that as Greenland melts, for example, or Antarctica, the mass from those places redistributes elsewhere in the world and more. So the effect of that is that when Antarctica starts melting, the North Atlantic is actually going to gain a little more height than the global average. I know that seems counterintuitive, but so there are some little adjustments to the global average. But it's reasonable to estimate that when sea level has risen a meter, that it will be more or less a meter worldwide. Now, some places, instead of, you know, it may be 80 centimeters, and in some places it may be 1.2 meters when we have global average 1 meter. And again, the places where the land is subsiding, like New Orleans and Jakarta and Venice, Italy, those places where the land is going down will see even more than global average sea level rise.
Thank you. Another good question. Can you give examples of places that are doing a good job of planning for much higher sea level, from Chris in Maine?
Sure. Lots of coastal cities are talking about the problem, from Miami and Fort Lauderdale up to Annapolis, Maryland and San Francisco. But I would say that in terms of the cities doing above average jobs of planning for the future, looking out to the long term, Boston in the United States probably has the most comprehensive outlook to what do they do with up to 5 feet of sea level rise by later this century. That's very bold thinking. Singapore is probably even ahead of that, looking ahead to meters of sea level rise, seeing the longer term. Their newest airport terminal is designed to have 5 meters above sea level. So and the Netherlands is looking, even though they have great coastal defenses, they too have to rethink things in the era of rising sea level. So it varies greatly by location, but those are some good examples.
Another question from Avery in California. Are there any good programs or efforts to help everyone move to high ground or address climate refugees with dignity?
I think there are a number of efforts and programs, but there's no large-scale global program. Certainly, it's talked about more and more. The challenge is, do we deal with the flooding we're seeing today at high tides, which is both a problem in South Florida, but Bangladesh and Vietnam and so on? Or are we better off thinking a little more futuristically and saying, it's not just what's happening now, but what will happen in 30 years' time, let's say mid-century, because the scale of the solution will change. And some things that may work for 5 centimeters of water rise, a few inches, will not work for 5 feet. So given that there's over 100 million people at risk of flooding, and some estimates would say it's more like 500 million people this century, it's a challenge we've never considered. I mean, right now we find 1 million refugees a year, a daunting problem. And of course, it's a terrible problem. But to imagine that times 100, but the difference is that sea level is relatively slow. It's not going to come in like a crashing wave during a hurricane, which is what we tend to visualize. Sea level is the drip filling the bucket, but the water level keeps rising. And so we need to be concerned about that equity solution, and certainly for the people who can least afford it. But this will challenge us because we think sea level is sea level, and we think of water flooding as temporary during a storm event or an extreme high tide. But sea level will be that drip filling the bucket that just keeps getting higher. And so I like to think that we should think short, medium, and long term. Short term thinking is 10 or 20 years. Medium term is 30 years and longer. And long term thinking is 100 years. How do we design for the future? And it's useful if we think of it that way. What do I need to do for flooding that could happen in the next year or two? That's one thing. What do we need to do now for flooding that can happen by mid-century, 30 years from now? And for design purposes and engineering, what do we need to think about looking ahead 100 years, knowing that so much of our infrastructure, our roads, our airports, our ports, our power plants, our water supply systems have lasted for centuries? So we need to think at those three different timescales, and I think that really helps.
Thank you. Now, pick a photo, a question for my friend in Norway. You say that we cannot stop rising sea level, even if we stop using all fossil fuels. Can you give us an estimate for how much we could slow the rate of sea level rise this century, if at all possible?
Great question. How much could we slow the rate of sea level rise, depending if we really work at it and reduce fossil fuel emissions, burning fossil fuels? The estimates that I probably evaluate put most credit to would say that we can probably slow the rate by 30%. Now, that's, again, an approximation, depends on how aggressive we get to slow the warming. But let's assume that in the next 30 years, we can slow the rate by 30%. So instead of a foot, maybe we get 9 inches, or if it's a half 30 centimeters, if it's we only get 20 centimeters. That's a significant improvement. The worst or the bigger effect will happen in the second half century. And so again, we have to look at scale. Again, if we look forward to 50 centimeters, a foot and a half by mid-century, and up to 2 or 3 meters by the end of the century, slowing the warming and slowing the melting ice and slowing sea level rise by 30% would be great. And we should try and do that. But we need to think of both, if we're successful and if we're not.
Very well. Another question from Luna Xiao. How and where did you get the historical measurements of global temperature and sea level?
Okay, great question. So if you remember the ice core pictures where we drill down in the ice sheets of Antarctica and Greenland, 140,000 years of ice remains in Greenland and up to 800,000 years of ice in Antarctica, and they correlate. So we know that they're accurate because different teams from different countries on both ice cores have come up with the same understanding from the first 140,000 years. The bright spots in that ice core that I showed are air bubbles, and they're compressed as the snow trapped air and turned into ice and then pressurized ice under weight. Those air bubbles are pressurized air samples. And we can date them now, just like you would look back into the rings of a tree and get historic pictures of what happened when that tree was growing. We can get a different insight into history as layers of snow turned into ice, going buried now down under the ice sheet. And in those air bubbles, our air samples, of course. And there's two different isotopes of oxygen, 16 and 18. And without getting too technical, those different isotopes of oxygen vary in percentage according to temperature. So locked in the ice sheet of Greenland, 140,000 years that we can measure, and Antarctica, 800,000 years, we can get relative temperature going back that far. Sea level we get by finding ancient shorelines and then having to adjust for land uplift or subsidence. We can kind of back out, if you will, where that land was. So you might see shark's teeth up on a hillside 100 feet above sea level, or actually marine sediments on the top of Mount Everest. But geologists can kind of reverse calculate what that elevation was when those marine sediments or shark's teeth were laid down. So it's very sophisticated in different fields of science, but that's how we can tell ancient sea levels, and that's how we can tell ancient temperatures. And so that's how we decode that, and carbon dioxide as well.
Thank you, John. Lots of complicated, technical, but important questions. Can I send a couple of more your way?
Of course.
Okay, so we have one from Carol in Maryland. How do we include social justice, environmental justice into resilience?
I won't pretend to have an answer to that, because the truth is all of us should be thinking about that. I mean, if we have the insight that flooding is going to happen more often from storms and heavy rainfall, and king tides are predictable, but they're getting higher as sea level gets higher and higher, and then there's coastal erosion. So the adjustment at the coastal margin, at the coastal areas of the world, all over the world, which is probably 40% or more of the population is in the coastal zone. In fact, by some estimates, up to 60%. We all need to think about how to create an equitable world and take care of those least able. The only bright spot I can see about sea level rise, besides our hopefully slowing it, is the fact that we have time to adjust. The thing is, we can't wait. We need to start thinking now, recognizing that the flooding from sea level will happen gradually over the coming decades. That's the opposite of a hurricane or a tsunami, which causes its damage and deaths, you know, instantly. Sea level rise is very slow, but it's unstoppable. So we can turn that inevitability and potential injustice and concern for humanity and turn it around and realize that if we start thinking of higher sea level now, that it's going to be 5 or 10 feet, a half, you know, a meter, up to 3 meters this century, now's the time to start planning our world differently. We've never faced this threat before, and certainly doing it with consideration to the poor, the developing countries and even the poor people in the United States who will have difficulty adapting, now is the time to educate and begin thoughts about adaptation.
Very well. Actually, I lied, not two questions, I have a few more. It's a very interesting topic. Many small island nations will be catastrophically affected by sea level rises in the future, including the Bahamas, which I believe you know very well, John, for having lived there many years. So there's a question from Rene in the Bahamas. How can you specifically address an issue, for example, with a country like the Bahamas, which has about 715 islands, only a handful inhabited? Since you know the place very well, how would you advise the government of the Bahamas, for example, to be better prepared against sea level rise?
It's a good question. And I do know the Bahamas well. I lived there for more than 25 years. And it's a lot of different islands, but as you say, only a few dozen inhabited. I think the Bahamas can be an example to others that we need to think out over a century and think short, medium, and long term. So the flooding that could happen next year with another terrible hurricane, as they've been hit in recent years with Dorian most recently, and several others that have done great damage there, that's one kind of flooding. But thinking about the building codes again and recognizing that there's different kinds of flooding, there's weather, storms, heavy rain, and runoff. then there's extreme high tides, then there's sea level rise, and then there's coastal erosion. We need to have a different kind of zoning and building codes that look out, recognizing that while we may think we may only own a house for 5 years, we often live in that house for 20 or 30 years. And if we want to think about leaving that asset to our children or grandchildren, or just to help design a world that is now going to face sea level rise, and it's happened before, we just didn't know it, that as I pointed out in the slides, 122,000 years ago, sea level was 25 feet higher by nature. So while we can get upset that maybe we have warmed the planet and we were warned not to, the truth is higher sea level was also natural. So they're both have happened. And what we need to do with this new knowledge is begin doing for future planning differently. We need to think short, medium, and long-term. And as I say, I think mid-century is kind of the midterm, and 100 years from now is the longer term. And if we think like that, we will change building codes. We will change zoning. We will change land use policies.
Talking about building codes, we have a question from Howard in Miami about real estate. I am the first building in the beach. We have already flooded a few times. Should I sell my property now?
The decision whether anybody should sell their property really is a personal decision. It depends upon their age, how much of their assets are represented by that property. Do they just need to, you know, if somebody's 20 years old and going to buy something with a 90% mortgage and be, you know, dependent upon the value of that building or home, that's one situation. If somebody is 85 years old and has other investments and maybe it's a second home and wants to live on the beach, c'est la vie, you know, why not enjoy it? So I think for each person, it depends upon your age, your wealth, how much you're vulnerable to a flooding event, and whether you need to preserve that value for future generations or whether you can enjoy it for the rest of your life and not worry about it.
Very well. Last question from Jenny. Could you please address the issue of permafrost melt and the rise in sea level? Do you see a bigger danger for the islands of the Indian Ocean like Rodriguez, Mauritius, or Réunion, which are well confirmed Réunion is one of the most beautiful islands in the world, in case you have not seen it? Thank you.
Well, I think there's two different questions in there. So, and I've not been to Réunion or Madagascar or any of those parts. So I look forward to that one day. And of course, islands are different all over the world, from the Indian Ocean to the Pacific to the Caribbean, Bahamas, Atlantic. Each one needs to be seen differently because of its
profile. If I may say, this is actually the importance of that question is that I think the person was trying to compare islands that are very close geographically speaking, but they're so different. Mauritius being relatively flat, Réunion Island being an active volcanic island. So it's a very complex issue, and we thank you for answering that question. Please go ahead.
Thank you. Elevations of islands vary greatly. You can have very low-lying islands like the Maldives or Kiribati, which are just a meter above sea level, or the Marshall Islands, okay? And then you can have volcanic islands like Hawaii or Puerto Rico or different places, as you mentioned. So yes, the profile of the island, the topography matters. But the first part of that question I thought was the more important part. The permafrost, there were two parts to that question. The permafrost melting was the first part. And let's go back to that. The thawing of the permafrost has two effects on sea level, and they're a little obscure and it's misunderstood. So it's a good opportunity to clarify. If you look in the Arctic, like the islands off of Alaska, Shishmaref and or Kivalina, towns on the smaller parts of Alaska, or off Siberia, or the Canadian Arctic, the permafrost, which is ground that, as we know, has been frozen year round for multiple years, it's just frozen ground. But with the strong winter waves in the Arctic, let's say Alaska as an example that I know, having studied it, during the winter months, they get these fierce storms, but they've had ice sheets on the shoreline and the ground has been frozen. With the warming, the ice sheets are disappearing and the permafrost is thawing. So the winter waves are clawing away at the island, at the beach, as you will, the coastline, and that didn't used to happen. And so where people have seen examples of, as I say, Shishmaref and Kivalina are notable because there are plans to relocate the entire village. It's not because of sea level rise. It's because of the thawing permafrost, which has made the beaches soft during the wintertime and vulnerable to the winter waves. So that's one situation, okay? So the thawing permafrost exacerbates or speeds up coastal erosion as opposed to sea level, but that is an effect and it's a problem. And it's getting worse through the Arctic. The second aspect of the thawing permafrost that has an indirect relationship is that there's a lot of methane trapped in the northern climates like Siberia and North Canada, particularly Siberia. And as the ground warms, there are two sources of methane coming out of the frozen permafrost. And also as the sea warms, the seabed has frozen methane beneath the seabed. And methane is coming out of the seabed and the permafrost ground as the world warms. And that methane's a real problem because, as some of our viewers know, methane is actually a stronger greenhouse gas than carbon dioxide, actually more than 80 times stronger. Now, it deteriorates and breaks down into carbon dioxide, but over a course of a century, it's still many, you know, far, far stronger than carbon dioxide. And that's a concern because as the world warms, we're not in control of that methane release. So that's an aspect of permafrost that will add to the warming, which will hasten the ice melting, which will add to sea level. So there's an indirect connection there as well.
Well, thank you very much, John, for informing us on a very critical part of some of the future challenges we are facing, as if the current ones were not enough. Thank you everyone for joining us today. Thank you to the Explorers Club team for the logistical support. We have already past allocated our time, so I cannot ask any more questions, unfortunately, but that shows how important the topic is. We received a lot of questions today. Stay tuned tonight. We have a program on sustainable seafood at 7 p.m. Eastern time, prepared by our Explorers Club Unrivaled, Julie and Alex Wallace, who have invited a rich panel of outstanding knowledgeable guest speakers, like Cara Safina, Paul Greenberg, Brent Smith, Jen Levine, and Monica Van Cleef Talbert. As guest speaker, and the topic will be also one of the most important of the 21st century, sustainable seafood. Stay tuned. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Damien.
Love, but now that friends, we're out of time, and it's slowly passing by. Right before our eyes, we like the deepest ocean, send photographs of Mars. We're so enchanted by how clever we are. Why should one baby feel so hungry? She cried. Salt water wells in my eyes. Salt water wells in my eyes.